social justice issue, which I need to end here in a few minutes, is the last chapter we're dealing with. Let me just say this. The new issue of foreign affairs is very interesting. It's the 90th anniversary issue. Francis Fukuyama has this piece, The Future of History, in this. It's very interesting to read what they're saying, because I think it's very true. The great struggle over social systems is what occurred since the time of the Communist Manifesto in 1850 till really now. It was decisively concluded that democratic capitalism works better. Now, Leonid Hurwitz, independent of the collapse of communism, showed at a theoretical level that capitalism was the only system that gave us what we want, we meaning anybody on earth. If I had the slide here, which I don't seem to have of that. It gave us efficiency, equity, stability, privacy, and freedom. This is amazingly interesting work. No other system can deliver those things, which is what everybody polled wants. This is not an opinion, it's a 40-page theorem. Another Nobel Prize. The problem is, if you look at the 40 articles that have been published in the last 40 days in the Financial Times, all branded capitalism in crisis, you didn't typically see one person define what capitalism even is. Do you wonder that the occupiers of Wall Street are flaky and confused, so it's easy to laugh at them? They don't know anything. They're confused. But the French have the right word for this, idiot savant. They're absolutely right. The system stinks. It's rigged. Equality of opportunity is being basically dismantled. It's a real mess. Right. Theorem number one. Under true capitalism, Goldman Sachs wouldn't exist. Did you know that? Can anyone here prove that? Bit difficult. True capitalism, Adam Smith, mathematized by Arrow and De Bruyne in 1953, and then more importantly, by Robert Aumann in 1977, means no agent has any bargaining power whatsoever. It's every wheat farmer takes prices as given, and you can't gang up against me with someone else. The notion of four investment bankers taking a private plane to Washington to make sure that in exchange for nice payments, leverage for broker-dealers was tripled in April 2004, which would, of course, cost 20 more million people their jobs when the system fell apart, is outrageous and scandalous, and they all ought to be in jail, correct? Were Adam Smith to see what's been going on, he wouldn't turn in his grave, he'd gyrate and wrote about it. The kids are right. It's rigged. Let's talk about equality of opportunity, central to the concept of the American dream. The whole story was, even if you don't have money, the Woody Brocks of the world, through their generosity, made it possible for anybody to go to Harvard, and it makes no difference if you have no money. If you're more talented than she is and you have no money, you get in. It's called blind admissions. Nice, eh? No more. No. We're undermining equality of opportunity in a way that's very bad. 70% of Americans now think their children will live worse than they will. Think that's a good way to face the future, or do you think the pitchforks might be coming out? Normal middle-class people, and I think it was Trotsky or Marx who said, without the bourgeoisie being happy, there is no private property but capital. The bourgeoisie have gotten away with deluding themselves in the last 40 years that they're living well, because two things happened on the way to the forum. Number one, people married and both had incomes. That was brand new. Two incomes permitted our family to continue to live well. And then secondly, the availability of types of and acceptance of credit exploded. In 1900, we think that private household debt in America was about 1 or 2% of GDP. What is it here now? 130? Well, we're in the same boat. It's an Anglo-Saxon problem. It's not true of Switzerland and Germany as much. So the point is, we thought we were living better, but we weren't. And now, those people with their iPods and their leased cars find they can't pay for their health insurance premiums, they cannot pay for their school children, for their kids, where state colleges are now charging $15,000 a year because all the money is being siphoned away from state and local budgets to pay for thugs known as policemen and firemen who have extorted $300,000 pensions. They get the money. The kids have to now graduate massively in debt. I am not happy about this, as you can tell. This undermines equality of opportunity, without which there is no American dream. And that's why these issues of fairness are popping to the surface and they're important. Let me wrap up with a little bit of thinking about what you can take away and leave when thinking about this issue. This is deep stuff. I have to sort of think for a minute here how to put this. I want to talk about capitalism. I want to praise it. True capitalism. It's the interior of an onion. It's moist. It's flavorful. Cooks love it. You can do anything, sweeten things, sour things. But when you buy an onion, what are you looking at in the store? Is it pretty or not? Scaggy and scaly, and the chef does what? Just gets rid of the outside. That's Goldman Sachs. That's people who have power and use it and rig the system. That's K Street in Washington. I have nothing against Goldman. And then you get to the interior of the onion, which is terrific. So let's do that in our own world. Let's forget the financial world with Doric temples with gilded columns promising that you'll be bailed out because you're too important and rich to fail. Let's just forget all. Let's scrape it off. We're left with a real economy of about 90%. Bra makers, chair makers, eyeglass makers, table makers, car makers, bed makers. The CEOs of those industries go to bed every night with one major concern. What is it? Will I survive my competition? Look at Japanese consumer electronics. It's collapsing. They didn't keep up. Is there any Doric temple to save them? No. It's competitive. It's Adam Smith. It's Darwinian. What's the result? 4 billion people buy better beds and cars every year for less. Living standards in 300 years in the West have gone up 30-fold. In the previous 1,000 years, from 700 to 1700, we think they doubled. Oh no, true capitalism is the most fabulous invention in history. That's why we want to make sure people are told this and that they don't confuse true capitalism with corrupted, crony, bastardized capitalism, because if they do confuse it, they just may throw the baby out with the bathwater, correct? So I don't like that. Finally, fair shares. We'll end with that. The most extraordinary statement in modern political history, probably in 500 years, was Karl Marx in 1848, "Workers of the world unite. You have nothing to lose but your chains, from each according to his contribution, to each according to his needs." Now, is that inflammatory? It can be shown in theories of social justice that you can actually think of a two-stage state of nature, sort of Rawlsian contract theory story, where number one, you have to pick the constitution and the tax rates under which you live, and then you go out in the real world subject to those rules, and you live under a different norm. So I'm going to be a typical person. Between 8 and 5, to each according to his contribution applies. Think of a sports team surviving if you give Tom Brady the lowest bonus. He's the Patriots star. He's MVP. Now, if you sell twice the Volvos that he does, who gets the bigger bonus? So it's a theorem in economics. Everybody receives as his or her pay his marginal contribution, to each according to his contribution. Try running a company without it. The proof is by contradiction. If I pay you more than you're contributing by the zero excess profits axioms of perfect competition, my company goes broke. And if I pay you too little, what do? You move. The notion of somebody sacking a company, firing the employees to avoid pension payments on New Year's Eve before midnight, and then jumping off with a $50 million golden parachute, Adam Smith would spin in his grave, not gyrate. It's so unattractive. That's part of the bastardized system we now live under. It has nothing to do with capitalism. To each according to his contribution is not a right-wing concept at all. It's what we all live under from 8 to 5. A faculty doesn't pick the most needy person, but the most contributory person for an appointment. But wait a minute. Maybe the more needy person who doesn't get tenure. Well, do we feel that's fair? She, he needed maybe the money more. Excuse me, wrong. You want the best faculty. But you also want to know that in stage one of the problem, now we're back to the original thing of picking basic institutions, you want to know that at that stage, decisions were made that if you ended up unlucky and ill and with a problem, you would be taken care of. You think of to each according to his need in picking such things as those, right? In economics, the notion that somehow efficiency has nothing to do with fair shares is wrong. As Adam Smith pointed out, there is no market system unless you have good Supreme Court justices, the rule of law, etc., correct? Public goods. So from the beginning, since markets don't determine how much to charge for public goods that we all share, a choice must be made who should pay how much for the army and the courts. It was always known that you don't charge equally. The people whose little income should pay proportionately less, as the utilitarians first proved, than the people with more. So I'm very interested by this intersection of ethical issues with economic issues. But the point here is, in stage one, to each according to his needs is paramount. Because at the table where we pick a constitution, nobody is contributing more than anybody else to the choice. In stage two, you sell twice as many cars as he does, you're hustling, you're working, you ought to make more. So the point is, the notion of to each according to his needs and to each according to his contribution, contrary to Marx, who set up a tension between these, both of them rest happily together at home in their own respective domains of life. And when I'm writing my will after work at 8 o'clock at night, and I happen to have three nieces that will have tens of millions each, and two nephews that won't have any, what do I do with my money? I ask who's more needy, correct? And they'll get the money. And if I did it otherwise, it would be very strange indeed, because they need the money to provide education and housing for their children. And that's a true story. And my nieces are absolutely fine with that. They would have thought it's very odd if it weren't true. And I've discussed this at length. I've overstayed my welcome. This last most explosive topic, fair shares, which really is enough to get the hair up on anybody, is once again being shown not to be a left-wing, right-wing story. You have both contribution justice and needs justice in their proper domains. So I don't see this as really left or right-wing, because in my own life, I'm subject to both norms at different times of day. Thank you very much.